buddy wouldn't catch on nearly as much as greed.
Oh, the chocolate experience you've been waiting for.
Greed makes me think things. Things God doesn't want me to think.
Green, voiced by Cree Summer, who I don't think gave that character a take over the world plot yet, was the first female M&M and was made to promote the dark chocolate, mint, or peanut butter brand. Her main thing was she was the sexy one. Because DeviantArt is writing commercials now.
Well, my new movie's opening. And no, Dennis, I don't remove my shell.
Of course not.
So I'll be honest, at first I didn't really like Green because back then, whenever a girl entered an all-boys club, she was either forgettable or just the sexy one. Looking back though, she's actually not as bad as I remember. First of all, she does have a personality. She's kind of a diva, has a glamorous confidence to her, but is also pretty cynical.
I don't know which one works. Thanks guys, I need a bath for dinner.
Come buy a bag.
Honestly, I'd argue she has more personality than Blue. Secondly, a lot of her character is based around one big in-joke. In the 70s, an urban legend arose that green M&Ms make you horny. How, why, who, nobody explains, but let's be honest, is that really the craziest thing you heard from the 70s? There was even an ad that almost straight up addressed it.
Question, Sugar.
Yes, Dennis.
Is it true what they say about the green ones?
That is an ugly rumor. It's a lie! How did this thing get started?
Okay, so you're not lying.
Lime?
Where do you get your gossip?
Knowing that starting out actually makes a lot of this pretty clever. And honestly, a sexy M&M is just funny to me. It's literally a circle, and they play it off as like the most erotic thing in the world. It actually gets some really good laughs, especially when you see how seriously some of the actors play it.
That's what boys do.
But he's my little boy.
At his age, I'd be concerned if he wasn't interested.
It allowed for a lot of surprisingly risque jokes, and to the character's credit, everyone stripped down at some point, usually on multiple occasions.
Don't, eyes down. Nothing to see here.
Correct once again.
She actually gets funnier the more I look back on her. The next one on the list is Orange.
You're that new crispy M&M's guy, huh?
Oh, are you trying to get me killed?
Orange is my favorite character. Voiced by Eric Kirchberger, Orange represents the crispy brand and the pretzel brand. His whole character is, he's super paranoid. Where the others are good at smoothly avoiding being eaten, he's just freaked out by everything. He's freaked out about dying, he's freaked out about women, he's freaked out that a pretzel is apparently gonna be shoved up his ass.
All right, let's get this over with.
He just cracks me up. He's a total spaz. Every time I see him, I feel sorry for him, which just makes me laugh even more. I'm feeling sorry for an M&M.
Could you just for one second put yourself in my place?
That's funny. there's your cousin. Oh. That's your first date,
Cheryl. It's kind of like those pigs you see advertising barbecue. What if they became really aware of what they were doing and they just spiraled into a depressive episode? There's just something so bizarrely morbid about it that I can't help but crack up. He's definitely a keeper to have around.
I don't know why everyone wants to eat the crispy M&Ms. I mean, I know I'm...
Next came Brown. Or Miss Brown, because I work for her? Yeah, none of the others had titles before their names, unless you count white M&M. Voiced by Vanessa Williams and representing plain and dark chocolate, I almost feel like she's a response to any hate Green might have gotten in the past, because she's the complete opposite. While Green is fun-loving, Brown is all business. While Green is a wisecracker, Brown tells no jokes at all. And while Green loves being sexy, Brown is constantly pissed that everyone confuses her for being naked.
Only a fool would think I'd actually show up naked.
So it's that kind of party, isn't it?
I'm sexy and I know it.
She's so serious she should do a detailed commercial about her getting insurance from the Geico gecko. That happened!
Geico only insures humans.
Guess what day it is!
Save it, hot boy.
Despite being a stick in the mud, she...
Wait, that literally happened?
Does get some good laughs, particularly at the expense of the other M&Ms.
Steer clear of Kristen. She'll devour you.
Really?
Yeah, thanks for introducing us.
Anything for a friend.
She's a nice fit to the cast. There's been other side characters over the years, too. There's a chocolate bar, which things would always go bad for because he would melt in the sun. Get it? Melt in your mouth and on your hand. He was also voiced by Phil Hart. There's a pretzel that's sometimes Orange's wingman, voiced by Maurice LaMarche. And there's a cube of caramel, voiced by David Cross, who's always geeky. They're gonna fix him, though, by putting him in an M&M to stop him being so square. I know how lame that is, but they got David Cross, the only likable man in the Alvin and the Chipmunk movies. By God, I have to give a pass on this! The characters are so relatable that they don't even have to change the commercials much when advertising in other countries. Because the animation is already done, all they have to do is change the people out and the language.
Come buy a bag! Come on,
my final! Here's a more line. Come on, here's Pina.
He is. Here is the legend.
Because my little friend, I've just run out. Which one of you's peanuts?
He is. I hear he's delicious.
Their popularity is so big they've worked with pretty much everyone. Danny DeVito, Halle Berry, the X-Men, Shrek, Darth Vader, ooh, even Keith Apicary.
He's betraying his Skittle boombox.
Susan Kreidel even admitted she knew it would be a hit, but to have an M&M store based on the characters open in Las Vegas and still remain open for over 20 years was far beyond her expectations. And indeed, the lasting power of these characters probably went beyond anyone's expectations. At the very least, you hope your campaign will sell more of a product, but to create iconic characters that are still beloved and watched repeatedly on TV and YouTube is something very rare. Commercials have gotten millions of views before online, but there's so many compilations and so many people, both young and old, who love seeking them out. It's not just one commercial they like checking out, it's a ton of them. Not just because they're funny, but because the characters in them are so likable. It's always expected they're gonna have a Super Bowl ad every year. It's always expected the same Christmas commercial will play every year. And honestly, they could go even further. In the theatrical promo satirizing movie trailers, they say,
"This is why we don't make movies."
Why don't you? I would totally see that!
I want to see that too!
If Ernest, Willy Wonka, Uncle Drew, and Lego could get their own successful movies, why not them? The characters are already said they work great off each other. If the goddamn Geico cavemen could get their own show, yeah, that's right, Google it, actually don't. These guys could work great in a movie. Okay, so it's a successful campaign with successful characters. Why is that a big deal? We've seen other product mascots last a long time, even longer than them, in fact. Well, here's the thing. The M&M's mascot combined three things that I can't think any other product mascot combines. One, they're some of the few commercial characters that have looked exactly the same for over 20 years. Lots of characters last for a while, but they usually change with the times. True, at first they had to find their fitting, but within a year, they got it. And once they had that definitive look and personality, they kept it exactly the same for over two decades. That rarely happens. Two, they're surprisingly fleshed out characters. Even the best food mascots, like Tony the Tiger or Ronald McDonald, they're positive icons that sell their products, but they're not three-dimensional enough to write a movie or a show around. These characters are. Even though they're simple, they're still very human, and you identify with them very quickly. And three, they're some of the only commercial mascots that kids enjoy just as much as adults. Lucky is great for children, but not going to do much for adults. The Allstate guy gets a laugh out of grown-ups, but kids aren't really going to be sucked in by it. No matter what age, though, you laugh just as hard at these characters. Enough that some celebrities who don't really need to voice them out of necessity anymore still come back to recreate their roles every time. Even though they were just created to sell a product, they still created characters that are kind of similar to ones like Animaniacs or Looney Tunes. In fact, a lot of M&M ads have been even funnier than Looney Tune ads occasionally. For having only 30 seconds or less at a time, they created some clever, timeless, hilarious, and even at times kind of risque characters that people enjoy watching around the world. I'm not saying these are deep, complex character studies or anything, but they are funny, relatable, and imaginative icons in a field where only one of those qualifications is needed. They're commercials, yeah, but they're ones that we rely on seeing every Christmas, every Super Bowl, every time we need a good laugh. All I'm saying is a lot went into making these characters, a lot still goes into making these characters, and it's worth showing how appreciative we still are for that effort. I'm a nostalgia critic, I remember, so you don't have to. End credits a little differently, because a lot of times people don't wait through the credits, they don't watch it all, and they miss the charity shoutouts at the end. So if a thing goes, it's a good organization. So with that, Spy Company and this.
Well, at least Doug and I agree on something. Why isn't there an M&M movie? I want to see that. But not as much as a Disney Princess spinoff in hopes of Avengers and Star Wars being added to the mix.